I count it a real privilege to stand here, to be able to speak with you. I know the musicians did not think of my personal story when they picked the music today, but the passage of Scripture which brought me out of darkness into light is the passage in Ezekiel 36 that speaks about a God who's willing to take a heart of stone and turn it into a heart of flesh to wash us with pure water. And I was not a lifelong Christian. I did not become a Christian until I was almost 26 years old. Child of the 60s, would probably not be much of an exaggeration to say I politely hated Christianity. I remember I was working in a psychiatric hospital at the time. My plans were to go on into clinical psychology. And the last year of my working there was the first year of my life in Christ. And it's really interesting. And the one thing that psychiatric hospitals often do well from a human standpoint is saying goodbye to staff members who have been there, the quote, termination staff meeting. It was very tender, moving, a lot of emotions expressed. It was interesting to me, it was a comment that our head psychiatrist made. He looked at me, he got very personal for a moment. He said, you know, I've been watching you this last year, and it has always puzzled me how someone working here could become more religious. I've always thought that the devil ruled here. And interesting comment. My response was something along the lines of, in becoming a Christian, I realized that I'm not that different from the people that we take care of here. We are more alike than different. Different in degree, certainly. There's a reason I get to go home and they don't, but human. All the same struggles at just different quantities, you might say. And it's been God's great mercy that I would be able to count myself as a Christian. I get the privilege of closing our conference. I want to just make a couple of opening remarks, then dive in. One of the things I think is worth noting is that there is something odd in a conference about personal ministry, the care and cure of the soul, the conversational, get to know you, climb into your life. There's something odd about being 10 yards from the nearest person and up on a stage, and when the very thing we're talking and speaking from notes that you've had time to think about and prepare, when the very thing we're talking about is always improvisational, and it's always side by side, face to face, tell me what's going on with you. How are you doing? What's happening? How can I help you? I do trust that the God who values both public ministry, the teaching and preaching, as well as the private ministry, can be of some use, even though our model, you might say, through the entire conference is actually, we aren't modeling the thing we're talking about. You can't model it at a conference in this way. I want to basically do three things. I want to comment some about the conference name and theme, Counsel of the Word and the Sufficiency of Scripture, and what those things mean and what they don't mean. It's important to say what do we mean by those words and what don't we mean. Second, I want to look at some barriers to our being able to counsel the Scriptures, the words of life, the words of the living God, barriers that make it sometimes difficult for us and for other people to get a bead on what exactly does this look like to counsel well and wisely. And then I want to work together as a group. I want to bring a passage to life in our lives, have a bit of a sort of workshop together, thinking about some issue in each of our lives. Sufficiency of Scripture. Sufficient for what? Really important question, right? And what does that mean? And then in a moment, what does it not mean? Where it's often misunderstood. Word of God is sufficient for, we could fill in about 100 things. I'll just give a sampler. In the most general way, we could say the Word of God is sufficient to keep you oriented in a world that is disorienting, having a heart that tends to get disoriented, to generate disorientation and distortion. It's sufficient. In fact, it doesn't just orient you, it radically reorients you. It is a different take on reality. It is, Scripture is sufficient for that, the Word of God. Word of God reveals what is at stake in our lives, that you and the people that you counsel are full immersion participants in the multitude of problems of evil. And notice the way we put it. Sometimes the problem of evil gets talked about as though it's this kind of theological problem. How could God be both good and yet the world that he runs is so wicked? It's a very different question when you ask it from being immersed, from being part of and participant in the problems of evil, which are twofold. There's the evils that come at us, suffering and death and lies and heartache and being sinned against, and there's the evils that spring up from inside us. One of my favorite passages in terms of that orienting you to what is at stake is in Ecclesiastes 9, verse 3. There is an evil in all that is done under the sun, in that the same thing happens to all. And he's referring there to death, vanity, futility, disappointment, disillusionment, heartache, loss. Also, the hearts of the children of men are full of evil, and madness is in their hearts while they live. And there he's talking not about the evils that beset us, but the evils that arise from within us, the dislocation, the disorientation, the confusion, the wrong goals, the wrong worship. And after that, they go to the dead. So our lives, the human condition is bracketed with these dual evil, sin and misery. What's wrong within, the madness in our hearts, and death, and the innumerable shadows of death. The Word of God is sufficient for revealing himself. He reveals himself, the one who made us, the one who sustains us, the one who judges us, the one who searches our hearts, the one who loves us, the one who came for us, the one who renews us, the one who is our friend and our Savior and our King and our Master and our Lamb and our Lion and every other good thing. The Word of God is sufficient in revealing the goal towards which he is working in us. His presence, his power, his words, his wisdom are doing something. And he's working purposefully, and it's very explicit what his goals are. And again, it is a biblical faith is the only approach to, quote, counseling that actually sets the goal right. And the goal, to again pick from one of many possible ways of talking about this, to pick out Paul's words from the beginning of 1 Timothy, the goal of our instruction, the goal of our ministry, the goal of what we're doing is love, is a change in how you relate to other human beings, where you actually start to manifest the redemptive qualities of God himself, kindness, compassion, goodness, mercy, forgiveness, courage, love, tenderness, bearing other people on your heart. And it is a love that comes from, and he gives you three descriptors, a pure heart, a good conscience, a sincere faith. Three ways of talking about our inner renewal, our renewal vis-a-vis God, a pure heart that I actually am oriented rightly, worship the right things, pursuing the right goals, a good conscience, a conscience that is both accurate and active. I'm interpreting life rightly. I'm weighing my own life and other people and God and events and teachings rightly. And a conscience is good also, and that has come under the blood of the Lamb and knows that I am not, many of the things we just sang, I'm not accepted by a whole long list of things that aren't what God in Christ has done for me. And a sincere faith, which I take to be shorthand for everything that the Psalms portray of a human being alive to God, both in their need and in their joy. The Word of God is sufficient for identifying the crucial choice points in a person's life. the decision points, this fundamental question in every single person's life, every single day, actually every single moment. Where do I turn? Do I turn to God and the ways of life and the ways of wisdom? Or do I turn away from him and to the ways of foolishness and folly and selfishness and idolatry and you name it? Do I turn away from him to the 10,000 false gods? Or do I turn to him and from all that beckons me? The Word of God is sufficient to give very specific help and hope and directives and presence and power and reasons and instructions and all the things that help influence our choices. And the Word of God is sufficient to equip us for ministry. And at the heart of ministry is loving well and wisely. And we have a Word whose purposes are to create men and women who are actually able to love well and wisely, to bear other people upon their hearts, to identify with the plight and struggles of brothers and sisters, to care in a way that is then illuminating, helpful, encouraging, convicting, challenging, and so forth. In other words, Scripture is sufficient. It's a sufficient Word to inhabit reality. We must also say, though, what does it not mean? What do others hear, unfortunately hear at times? Our conference theme, Sufficiency of Scripture and Counsel of the Word, the conference name and the conference theme are things often misunderstood. And I think one of the things that's really important to realize is one of the common misunderstandings in the very people we want to reach when they hear a phrase that is very meaningful to us about Scripture's sufficiency. They hear us saying, everything you need to know is inside the Bible. That's what they're hearing. That's not what we're saying. Because everything we need to know is not inside the Bible. The Bible is, as I think I said this yesterday in the panel, the Bible is not it's not a labyrinth you lose yourself within and you find all knowledge there. The Bible is a window and a door and a gaze on all reality so that you can go know 10,000 things, but you're going to know them rightly. We just think about counseling. The very first thing you do is you say, what is your name? And that name is not in the Bible. Nor is the life story in the Bible. Well, my name's in the Bible, but it's a different guy, a different David. So we're not in the Bible. And then you ask their life story, and you ask what they're struggling with, and none of that is in the Bible. It's part of why I made the comment yesterday about I'd love to read good literature and read history and biography and watch film and things that just show life in action. You get this vicarious experience of 10,000 variants on people. But every single one of these, and here's what we are saying, Scripture makes sense of the kinds of issues people struggle with. So when we're talking about the sufficiency of Scripture, we do not mean by it that we believe that it is exhaustive or encyclopedic, as though everything that you want to know is inside the pages. Of course it's not. Some people think of it as a fat book, but it's not that fat. There's a ton of other things you want to know. This teaches you how to know them aright. While you open your eyes and you ask questions, you listen hard and you watch and you notice and you read and so forth. The Bible itself models this, of course, in a way we shouldn't even have to defend it. It's so obvious, but it is a common misunderstanding, as though we mean that by sufficiency, exhaustive, encyclopedic, total knowledge of everything. You think about the prophets and the apostles and the Lord himself. They were observant people. They knew many things. They were thoughtful people. They thought about what they were watching. They were honest people. They knew themselves. Their counsel was this. It arose out of the revelation of the living God, and it gathered up everything from flowers to wars to eagles and crows and mirrors and crops and flowers and the fact that when a housewife loses her money, she goes and looks for it, and how nations go to war. And sufficiency of Scripture, it does not erase the significance of human reason, human experience, observation, right use of Christian tradition and exegetical or teaching traditions that we have. It illumines, informs, and guides so that we remain clear-eyed, humble-hearted, open, curious about lots of different things. By counsel, the word, I think we're often misinterpreted to be saying biblical counseling is essentially and only and critically defined by quoting Bible verses to people. Well, we do quote Bible verses to people, very gladly. But that's not true, that that's the only one aspect of what's going on, any more than when we say preach the word, as if a good sermon is simply a collection of texts strung together. We've all heard sermons like that, usually by juvenile beginning preachers, and it gets really boring as they give you the 48th scripture in a row on the theme of whatever their sermon is about. And it's because they haven't thought about what one of those passages is saying and brought it to life with the stories and applications and thoughts and implications and all the things that go into actually preaching the Word of God relevantly to a congregation. It's not just the Bible verse that is the core. There's a message that engages us. And as we think about counseling ministry, the quoting of a scripture is not the only thing happening. I mean, you think about some of the dynamics in the room. I'll give you a half dozen dynamics that the person sitting in the other chair is thinking. One of them, they may have already answered a little bit, like, should I ask for help? That's a really hard thing to do. It can be humiliating, feel shameful. Will I ask for help? Will I actually let someone in? Will I stonewall? Will I pretend? Will I just give secondary issues? Will I just blame my wife? Will I ask for help? There's a whole ton of issues there about how you create an atmosphere that makes it a safe and good and holy place to ask for help. Or you think about this question. We're talking. I've decided to ask for help. Do I trust you? If I don't trust you, we're not getting off away from home base here, are we? Do I trust you? What are the things from the counselor's end that what are the kinds of love and candor and humor and care that actually create integrity, that create an atmosphere of trust, that I can really trust you? Third question that comes out is, will I be honest with you? If I've decided to ask for help and I trust you, I can be honest with you. Will I share with you what I love? I think I said this yesterday, what Paul Tripp calls the fine china of my life, the really hard things that are hard to put on the table. Will I listen to what you say? Will I engage with it? One of the interesting dynamics that when you've done a bunch of counseling, you realize is that you're the outsider. They've got what in war you call internal lines of communication. That person knows his or her life. They've been living it for 10 or 20 or 50 or 80 years, and they know a million things you'll never know. But will they take, in engaging with what you say, often you will find that the person is disagreeing with you at some level. No, you didn't quite get that right. This is what I meant. When a conversation is, when that's happening, it's actually a really fruitful thing, because they're we're now working together. They're helping me, the outsider, get a better bead on what he or she or that marriage is struggling with. And will I act on what we talk about? There's a big one. And that's going to hook into what kind of goals do we set? Are they practical? Can they be something the person can actually envision that with the help of God, I could do that or think that or believe that or make that different choice at the choice point? So counsel the word, just like preach the word, is not simply a matter of quoting Bible verses. Bible verses are part of it. They're central. But it's a much bigger activity that takes place. And the reason we use that phrase is because it is one thing that is so decisively distinctive about a Christian approach to this area we call counseling. That Scripture is right at the heart of what we do, while we do about 50 other things simultaneously. That's what we mean, a little bit of what we mean by sufficiency, what we mean by counsel the word, and some common ways it's misunderstood, and what we don't mean that those misunderstandings or caricatures or accusations are getting at. Second thing I want us to do together this afternoon is I want us to look at some assumptions, habits, blind spots that can make it hard to get how one would counsel Scripture, how one would do faithful pastoral care that is a ministry of the words of life, things that just get in the way. Give you seven. These will be quick, but they can at least be food for thought. One habit that I think gets in the way of people understanding biblical counseling is that the phrase ministry of the word is usually thought of as synonymous with the pulpit, with preaching. In other words, ministry of the word is thought of as implying someone doing what I'm doing now, standing up in front, doing a monologue to a crowd of people who are just listening, and it is a prepared, thought-through talk that is being given. Now, that is a lovely aspect of ministry of the word. It's a really good habit we have as Christian people that we believe there is value in talking to crowds, talking with crowds. It's a very efficient way to speak to people. And we've all heard sermons where every single person in the room was moved, touched, gripped personally by one person talking, expositing Scripture. But that very habit of seeing ministry of the word as synonymous with the pulpit, with preaching, with the scripted, prepared public discourse blinds us to the importance of the conversational aspects of ministry. Give you a couple of examples. It's a different set of habits, conversational and proclamational. Give you a couple examples. Jesus' own ministry. Does Jesus, in what we have recorded in the Gospels, does he more often proclaim, preach, teach, or does he converse? By a mile, it's conversations. I kid you not. 5-to-1 ratio, probably. He converses far more often than he proclaims. There are some proclamation events, a couple of situations described where he's speaking in a synagogue. He's actually in a literal pulpit there, the seat that the leader of the synagogue would sit in. And he preached what we would call a sermon on a hillside, the Sermon on the Mount, and he preached from a boat out in the lake when there was a crowd gathered on the shore. So he did do preaching events, but most often he was talking with people. It had that give and take. It had their question for him, or his question for them, or the back and forth, or he noticed something, he picked up on it, interacts with it, engages it. Then they've come back to him, they push back. It has conversational elements are what's happening all through the ministry of Jesus Christ. Even something such as what we often call from the later part of the Gospel of John, the upper room discourse. A discourse is a talk. I'm giving a discourse. The upper room discourse is not a talk, it is a conversation. There are at least a dozen interruptions. It is a conversation. And yes, Jesus does a lot of talking because he's about to go and it's final instructions. But it is not a discourse, it is an upper room conversation. And you get a lot of he said, and then this guy said, and this guy objected, and these guys were wondering about this, and Jesus interacted with that. And it's conversational ministry, and Jesus is a genius at conversational ministry. I would say, for most Christian people, it's not even a category. We think of the Bible as a book that one preaches from, gives talks from and about, not a book that is full, jammed with conversational anecdotes, stories, pieces. Or think about most epistles. There are a few letters in the New Testament that have what you might call an expository, let's unpack a passage. what Hebrews does with Psalm 95 is sort of more like what a sermon does. It has an expository quality to it. But most of the epistles are actually more like counseling than like preaching. We rightly preach from them, but we ought to notice that their form is actually more like what counseling is. There's a problem in view. It's focused on a particular need of the people who are being written to. It's pastoral care. There's all kinds of things in what happens, say, in a typical Pauline epistle. He's very self-revelatory. He talks about himself. He talks about his relationship with his hearers, where he has got one. It's personal. It's interactive. It's back and forth. It's affectionate. Or he's upset. Or they can probably see the tears on the page where he was weeping over them. And it has his joy. It has his prayers for them right there in the page. He's praying for them certain things. He's loving them. He's caring. He's aware of the pressures they're under. He's aware of the false teaching or the ways they're straying or the pride that's blindsiding him. These are counseling kinds of engagements that we have. Revelation 2 and 3, the letters to the churches, they aren't preaching. They're counseling. They all start with, I know this about you. And then Jesus just stirs the pot in seven different ways, this mixture of, here's the really good things in you. He's affirming people, complimenting them, noticing the graces in a person's life. That's what counseling does. He's noticing the hard things that they face. He's noticing their sins and the ways where they're falling short. He's dealing with the good in their lives, the bad that's in their lives, the hard that they're facing in their lives. And the things he says about himself are pointedly relevant to the particulars of that combination of good things, bad things, and hard things. It's all stirred together in the individual needs of those seven churches. It's counseling, now at a group level, but it's not preaching so much as where you just launch out with a prepared talk. It's engaging the hearers. We need not only the habits of preaching, the monologue, the prepared script, we need to learn the habits of conversation. And as we get good at that, we'll be able to go both directions in a way that the Bible, people in the Bible do that very freely. The church is often clunky at the counseling half. And that leads straight into my second one. Habits, even in the way we think about using Scripture, where we move from the text towards general application into life. You think about the typical sermon. I get up here, I start with a text, and after some kind of hook or introductory story or, you know, attempt to make some kind of human contact, basically it's going from the Bible, exposited forth, and then we move towards some kind of application at a general level. Never get specific in the application, like, hey, Heath, hey, buddy, a few things I want to say to you. That doesn't happen in a sermon. General application after exposition. Text moves towards life. But in counseling, life comes first. Life moves towards text. It's a different habit. Our habits in ministry are moving this direction. The habits we have to develop to become equally good at counseling move the other direction. You have to start with the problems. You start with how the person is doing and who that person is and what they are facing and where they struggle and where they're good and strong and gracious and where they're sinful and confused. And our theological training, our preaching practices, the habits of how we see the Bible used typically get us moving only one way, text outward. And it's hard to see the counseling realities that are embedded everywhere in the same scripture where life moves towards ministry and message is actually a response to what is there in front of me. There's that problem topical sort of emphasis. We need both. And that involves the development of unfamiliar skills and habits that have that relational give and take. Here's a third barrier often to just getting it with respect to conversational ministry. They are our theological habits. The habits of theological education and the way we often use Scripture or talk about Scripture essentially take a text which is full of people and passion and life and death and relationship and place. It's in times and places, and they tell you about the weather and the geography and the names of their enemies and all the turmoil, and you take out all of the particulars. You abstract a system. You abstract your theological, your systematic categories. So you come up with something, you read this, and it's not wrong to abstract, right? I value systematic theology, and I value biblical theology that looks at the great narrative of Scripture, the kind of storyline and how it unfolds. But what both systematic theology and biblical theology are doing is a kind of abstracting and pulling out a pattern from a myriad of details, and the Bible is all the details in that. Give you a couple examples. Every piece of the unfolding of redemption, from chosen before the foundation of the world, Jesus Christ incarnate, his death for us, his resurrection, the gift of the Holy Spirit, God's sovereignty, Satan, it's all there in the book of Ephesians. But it is absolutely unsystematic. It's almost like systematic theology in Ephesians got run through a confetti machine. And it's scattered. The creation gets tucked in chapter 3, and you've got redemption in chapter 1, and you've got the different things about Satan or the Holy Spirit scattered through. The reason that it's scattered is because the needs of ministry are what is driving the book of Ephesians. Paul had a teaching message for the people he was writing to. He was not trying to do systematic theology. We do systematic theology and biblical theology to help us. They help keep us oriented. They help us know where the boundaries are and what's true and false about the Holy Spirit and what's true and false about the doctrine of justification by faith and true and false about the identity and person of the Son of God, God-man, Jesus Christ. Paul Tripp was playing with us last night around this issue of our tendency to abstract and to suck out the immediate vitality of the text. Remember how he played with us early in his talk about Psalm 27? He said, Psalm 27, these first verses, they're about how the Lord is, he's light, he's salvation, he's a stronghold. I'll speak for myself. I was furiously taking notes. Sounded really good to me. And then he goes, I've just been committing a theological error. I've been tricking you. Because what it actually says is not the Lord is light, the Lord is salvation, the Lord is a stronghold. It is the Lord is my light. The Lord is my salvation. Therefore, I will not fear. The Lord is my stronghold. Of whom shall I be afraid? So all those things about his relationship to me, and then the implications for my temptations to fear, that's what was going on in the very text that reveals the Lord as those lovely, wonderful, abstract qualities. There's a danger, I think, we have in using what I might call speaking of the Bible in what you might call the abstract, impersonal tense. I've made that up as a tense, but it's language that is passive, abstract, and impersonal. Here's an example. It says in Romans 8, 1, that there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Now think about that statement. You've got a person sitting in front of you who is struggling with self-condemnation, feels like a failure, did fail. Others are slamming him, her. If only I hadn't done that, they're despairing. Does God really accept me? Is there hope for me? And to say, it says in Romans 8, verse 1, that there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We've missed that tendency to be kind of impersonal in our language and passive in our language, misses the opportunity. For example, why say it? Why not say God says? And why give the citation? They don't need the citation. They need it later, maybe, so they can go look it up. They need the message of that. And why say, there is therefore now? Because therefore now, it makes sense exegetically, because it helps you realize that Romans 8 is built on an argument that started in Romans 7. So therefore now is there for a reason. But does this person need to know that when that's not what you're going to be talking about right now? And for those who are in Christ Jesus, well, this person is not those. This person is a person, one person in front of you. And Christ Jesus is not a term we talk about in daily life. We talk about Jesus Christ. So what if you said something like, God does not condemn you. You are in Jesus Christ. He is merciful. He is kind. He has chosen you. He loves you. You failed. You're beating yourself. Other people are slamming you. He does not condemn you. What you've done in that, you've personalized it, you've paraphrased it in a sense, you've made it rivet into the need. You haven't done damage to Scripture. You haven't then said, I'm not going to tell you about Romans 8 or try to help you understand Romans 7 or the rest of the chapter. But what you've done in a ministry situation is a kind of personalization of a message to a person in their need. You haven't abstracted it. And guess what? The kind of thing I've just described is actually the way the Bible itself quotes earlier Scripture. The Bible does this all the time. And it creates huge conundrums in Old Testament, New Testament exegesis, and New Testament use of the Old. And those are appropriate things to wrestle about. But I think often missing in those discussions is that the New Testament and later parts of the Old, when they quote earlier, they are doing ministry. And ministry has a set of purposes that it's not playing fast and loose with the text. You've got to be faithful exegetically in terms of the meaning of the text. But you're actually putting the text to work in a new situation. And so it's going to affect whether or not you even mention the verse. The Bible, for example, the New Testament will sometimes say, you know, it says in Isaiah. Sometimes it'll say, it says somewhere. And sometimes it won't even bother to say it, and it'll give a paraphrase. It's just an allusion. Why? Because they're doing ministry. And ministry works with a living, vivid, vital, connecting text to people in their need. Fourth thing that I think can be a habit that gets us in trouble is habits of, in a sense, and this got alluded to by a previous speaker, the topical proof text, atomizing the Bible into little topical bits that you could look up in a concordance, and thus you can have your anger verses, your marriage verses, and so forth. And it's interesting because the tendency to view the Bible atomistically as a topical textbook is actually characteristic of two different competing false views of how to use the Bible. One of them is a kind of form of biblical counseling that is actually quite immature. It's what you might call biblicistic, where you have to find the proof text for the problem. I think that's part of why Jeremy liked the article I wrote on body dysmorphia, Adonis complex, guys that want to be buff, because there's no proof text. So it gives you a way of thinking about that. But there's a tendency, if you get biblicistic, and I'm using that word in a bad sense, as though the Bible must be exhaustive, there must be a proof text. So I've seen things like this, that there is a proof text on anorexia. It's Psalm 102, verse 4, which says, my heart is struck down like grass and has withered. I forget to eat my bread. Now that is a lovely, heartbreaking text, and in context, captures a human experience of devastation. And you could even say there is a kind of, quote, anorexia, if you even want to use the word, when someone is so devastated by loss, they just don't have an appetite. But that passage is not talking about what our culture calls anorexia there. So what happens is on the biblicistic end, you say Psalm 102, verse 4 is the proof text. On the integrationist end, that also views the Bible as though what the Bible should be is a collection of all the texts and topics, then if anorexia isn't there, then since there's no verse on anorexia, let's use contemporary psychological theory and therapy to understand and treat anorexia. They're both viewing the Bible the wrong way there, whether you think there is a verse or whether you think there's not a verse. In fact, you could say the whole Bible is about the issues that come into play in what our culture calls anorexia, because it has to do with issues of fear of human disapproval, desire for control, a distorted image of what it means to be a woman or what beauty looks like, on, you know, certain anxieties that are able to be managed by a sense of control. There's really very particular struggles of heart and struggles of the kind of culture we live in, which lies to us with false views of what a human being is meant to look like, of what a woman's meant to look like, and what a man is meant to desire. The Bible recalibrates your vision. But there are many people who struggle because their vision is discalibrated. It's wrong. It's distorted. The Bible talks to those issues, but there's no proof text. It calls for a labor of thinking biblically in the ways that the sufficiency of Scripture tells us about a Scripture that orients us rightly. We can sometimes forget that the Bible gives innumerable clues that we are meant to think as we read it. A couple of examples. Galatians 5, the works of the flesh. The works of the flesh are obvious. Give you 15 examples and the like. That's interesting. Anorexia is not on the list. Lying is not on the list. There's tons of things that aren't on the list, but they're works of the flesh. Because it's supposed to be obvious once you get what the category is meant to mean. And those 15 examples just help give you some samples that guide, kind of prime the pump, give you some specifics, and then let you keep thinking about 115 more that are part of obvious and the like. Whether or not that particular one is in the Bible is very efficient in that way, in part because it expects us to take the cue and think about it. Or a couple verses later in Galatians, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, and so forth. And things like these, that's interesting. In other words, think about it. There's a ton of other, where's courage? That's a really important quality. Where's wisdom in counseling? That's a really important fruit of the Holy Spirit, and so forth and so on. James chapter 1. Consider it all joy when you meet various trials. I think of those things as blank checks. Every single one of us in this room can fill in our own particulars. And when you're counseling any human being on the planet ever, that person faces various trials. What are they? They're different from yours. How inefficient would it have been if James had tried to list every kind of trial it is possible for a human being to face, you know? If I had to list every kind of cancer and every kind of financial disaster and every kind of interpersonal conflict. Instead, he just says various trials and asks us to personalize it. Or Titus 3 talks about our life characterized by various passions and desires. Again, fill in the blanks. Some people crave to be liked. Other people crave to be included. Other people crave to be a success. Other people crave to be worshipped. Other people crave having sexual objects fall at their feet. Other people crave making a ton of money or winning an Olympic medal or having a good resume. A passage like that contains all of that and any other particular. So that habit of atomizing, topicalizing the text as though Scripture doesn't give us a million particulars and then also teach us how to think hard. Here's a fifth, really key in our culture. And, you know, this has been being talked about by biblical counselors for 40 years, but the issue is still live. There is a sectoring out of what you might call psychological problems, emotional problems, behavioral problems, relational problems, mental problems from, quote, spiritual problems. And that apartheid still exists, as though those things are two different categories. When you actually climb into the things that get called psychological, emotional, relational, behavioral, mental, those are perfectly lovely words. We can use them. They happen to be the same things, though, that the Bible talks about and we mean when we say spiritual problems. Spiritual problems are not just whether you have assurance or you're feeling guilty that, you know, God's not going to forgive you. It's a spiritual problem if you look in the mirror and you don't see the person that God made. Or if you walk into a room and you're really nervous about whether you're going to be included. And it sabotages love and makes you gripped by anxiety and fear. Those are psychological, emotional, relational, mental, behavioral, spiritual problems. That sectoring, that apartheid, that making the Bible irrelevant to most of life. Another example, addictions. It's so curious, isn't it, that if the deacon in your church gets drunk and sleeps with his secretary, he's a sinner. But if someone is a sex addict and an alcoholic, they aren't a sinner. It's been sectored out. So if you have got a little problem, and you should have known better and not done it, that could be sin. But if you got a really, really big problem, and it completely masters and dominates your life, it's in a different category. That's a mental problem. That's a psychological problem. That's an addiction. And in such a lovely way, the Bible makes us sane. The Bible orients us. It rightly helps us see what's actually happening in life. And yes, it's a grievous evil when the deacon gets drunk and sleeps with the secretary. It's a grievous evil when someone is absolutely addicted to internet porn and gets drunk every night. They're both grievous. All those things are grievous evils. And redemption needed, mercy needed, power needed. Sixth, tunnel vision about the human plight. I mentioned earlier this dual problem of evil. We are sinful and we are sufferers. There's probably 30 Psalms that have a distinct sense of personal guilt, culpability, and failure. There's probably 100 Psalms that have a distinct sense of affliction, pain, threat of death, I'm being beset. They're suffering, and there's sin. And the Psalms are about both. And they are both things that redemption handles. You tend to get the sin people and the suffering people, the life is hard people and the you're a bad person people. And the Bible just never does that, never bifurcates. It's a huge issue in even to our understanding of the gospel that we'll typically make the gospel simply about our sins. It is about our sins. It is also about our sufferings. On the last day, every tear is wiped away, and there's no more sorrow and sighing and death. And in 1,000 ways, Scripture makes clear the compassion of Jesus Christ for the afflictions of people who live in broken, hard, difficult places. And, you might say from a slightly different angle, they're intertwined at some level, profound level, his compassion on sinful people that came him, brought him to bleed and die on our behalf to change us. That habit, though, of fragmenting the problem of evil and kind of camping out on only one half of the issue. The Bible, the mercies, when you say the word the mercies of God, it addresses both parts. Psalm 103 is a great example. I bless the Lord because he forgives all my iniquity, and he heals all my diseases. He redeems my life from the pit, which is kind of the convergence of sin and suffering. He crowns me with steadfast love and faithfulness. It goes on to talk about his forgiveness of sins in the middle part of Psalm 103, and then it moves more towards the end to our fragility, to our suffering, the fact that we are like a flower in the desert, here today, gone tomorrow. So the entire human condition is in view, and you got to have both. And then finally, my seventh example that I think gets in the way of biblical counseling, are habits that can run quite deep within our evangelical world of expecting some kind of instant, dramatic, one-and-done change, as though, in a sense, the paradigm of the altar call in which someone can get saved is also the paradigm for the Christian life, as though the moment of coming to faith is also the exact same thing as what it looks like to grow and change lifelong. And what it leads to is a sense that a biblical counseling approach would be some version of just remember this one killer truth, or just remember some piece of the means of grace, just learn to have a quiet time, just get accountable, just get involved in a small group, just get into a ministry, just sit under good preaching, and all your problems will go away. Now, every one of those things is a good thing, but there's no just blank that makes the Christian life. A vision of a lifelong fixing, not a quick fix. There may be particular choice points that are very decisive in a particular season or at a point in time. I mean, if someone's committing adultery, they've got to stop. But there's going to be other kinds of struggles that, say, a struggle with anxiety. That's going to have a daily, even hourly component. It's going to be more like endemic struggle rather than epidemic struggle. You know, something that you deal with anxiety, learning in a thousand different ways what it means that you're not alone in the world. There's someone bigger than what threatens you. There's someone for you and with you. And that just takes typically a long time to seep in to a person's heart. It takes many trips to the well of grace. And rarely, I mean, there are times a wonderful one and done with certain kinds of high-handed sins. But most of the really tough stuff, like pride, self-righteousness, anxiety, grumbling, self-pity, loving pleasure, trying to control your world, there is no machete stroke that puts those things, cuts them down once for all. You know, they just have a way of growing back. And change is measured more by the direction you're heading than the fact that you attained final victory at moment X in your life. So we've looked at what our conference title and theme mean and don't mean. We've looked at a number of things that are just habits of how we use the Bible, how we think about the Christian life, that are endemic to us as conservative Christians who take Scripture seriously. I want us to close with a few minutes of making this thing we call ministry, Scripture, making it personal. And I want you to take a minute and just think, that we'd walk together. Remember I said yesterday, I think often we need to ourselves think about the sufficiency of Scripture, but it's more of a background truth. And what's often more important in the foreground is the relevance of Scripture, the pointed relevance. Let's do a little bit of a workshop together. And let's think about something where you are immersed, full immersion participation in the problems of evil. Your troubles and your struggles. Pick something. What's something in your life weighs on you? Perhaps it hurts, threatens, intrudes, pressure point. Word affliction in the Bible. Probably the best paraphrase of that is just pressure, pressures of life, trouble, hardship. What is a thing that troubles you? Let's hold that in mind. And then think a second step. How are you tempted to react? You know, we just have been singing about the fact that sin has this pervasive force in our lives. Where are ways that, what are your particular temptations that You know, is it anxiety, obsessing, just forgetting God, unbelief, anger and irritation, being a grouch, bad-mouthing people, making all your prayers be for God to fix your world, bitterness? Is it pleasure-seeking, some escape? When you think about those two things, the pressures of life, the typical reactions, we're really, there's our firsthand version for every single one of us, like every single person we will ever meet and counsel should we get the opportunity. Every single person has sins and they have sorrows. They have hardships that trouble them, and they have ways they express that trouble in some inner struggle that is revelatory of our fallenness. So hold that struggle in mind and heart. And I want us to just walk through together a really simple, familiar, basic passage. And I'm going to take it slow, and I want you to, in a sense, take that trouble and struggle, that external burden and that internal reaction that makes you lose your bearings, stray. And just let that, at each point, connect into this particular psalm. It's Psalm 23, right? As familiar as they get. Probably learned it, if you grew up in the church, you learned it in second grade, if not earlier. And I'm going to do two things as I just walk through the psalm. I'm going to read it with you in it. I'm going to talk with you about it. And I'm going to say a few things, and then I'm going to contrast it with, you might say, what's the opposite of this? What's the way we tend to live? You could call it the anti-psalm, the inversion of what the psalm is portraying. The Lord is your shepherd. You do not lack anything that you need. You are cared for by the living God. Personal, up close, freely chosen. He didn't love you by accident. He chose to care for you. And a shepherd protects, a shepherd provides, a shepherd leads to safety and to life. What does that do to that stressor and the stress and distress that we feel in that? That you're not alone. Someone else is present who actually cares for you. Here's the flip side. Death is my shepherd. That's pretty much a quote of Psalm 49, verse 14. Death is my shepherd. I'm on my own. Nobody's looking out for me. Nobody protects me. I'm always restless. I'm easily frustrated. I'm often disappointed. I'm disillusioned. That, in a sense, you see this contrast, these two realities, these two journeys, these two paths, this fundamental choice in life, right? We move on. He makes you to lie down in green pastures. He leads you beside still waters. In other words, he nourishes you. He takes you to places that are safe. He cares for you. He looks out for your actual need, your actual needs. We're actually being given reasons why we lack nothing that we need. What does that do? Is that, you might say, butts heads with the trouble and the distress and the sins and the temptations to forget. To forget there's actually someone makes you lie down in green pastures. And here's the flip side. It's not green pastures and quiet waters. Life is a jungle. I'm on guard. Often feel overwhelmed. It's threatening. Life is a desert. I'm thirsty. He restores your soul. It's interesting that word restores. It's got some of the overtones of the word for turning, repenting, turning back, being brought back to health and strength. And it's just that wherever we're sort of gone and distracted and confused and hurting and struggling and straying, he restores us. He like turns us back. Directly meets where we struggle. Here's the flip side. Sometimes my soul feels broken and twisted and stuck, and I can't fix myself, but I keep trying. I try a million things to fix myself, but I'm never really restored. And the longer I live, the more jaded, cynical, depressive, grumpy old man I become. Contrast, right? He restores my soul. He leads you in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. I think we sometimes make this a little bit too narrow, as though righteousness is only the moral quality of doing the right thing. I think what it means actually, it includes the moral rightness. It also includes the world made right. In the Psalms, righteousness and peace are just cousins. They're two different ways of talking about a world that goes wrong being made into a world that's going right. He leads me in paths of righteousness. And then think about this one. Why does he do it? He does it for his own sake. It's not like he looks at me and my struggle, looks at you and your struggle, says, you know, that person's really pitiful, I think I'll show kindness to him. Or that guy's such an idiot, you know, but I guess I'm going to be merciful. He acts for his own name's sake. You could almost say, this would be a paraphrase of Psalm 25, oh Lord, when you think on me, when you think on my shortcomings, remember who you are. Remember your goodness. Remember your steadfast love. For your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my iniquity, for it is very great. It's this, when he thinks on us, he remembers himself. That changes the rules, doesn't it? Then you look at the contrast. It's not paths of righteousness. I stumble down some very dark paths. But I insist, I want to do what I want, when I want, how I want. Actually, a quote from a lady that was delighting in her liberation from having to take care of her kids and be married. There's an interview on BBC with a British woman. I want to do what I want, when I want, and how I want. And I can remember thinking, boy, she feels like she is on a mountaintop and she is heading right over a precipice. The alternative is to be led in paths of righteousness. Or think about this one. And here the psalm is starting to move right to dead center because it's starting to bring into view those troubles and struggles, those sorrows and sins, those pressures and distresses. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. And actually, the center of the entire psalm is that last line. And it goes, so we're on a journey. We have a shepherd who cares for us. Doesn't it sound so good? All that starts to chip away, interact, soften our struggle. And then it's like he comes right out and says, the journey often goes through a valley of the shadow of death, and there are many evils that is easy to fear, and I'll fear none of them for one reason and one reason alone. You are with me. And, you know, if you study that psalm, you realize that's a place where in the actual psalm, it turns from the third person into the second person, from the Lord is, he does this, he does that, you are with me. And it grabs it together. You think about the alternative. Life's confusing. Why don't things ever really work out? I'm haunted by emptiness and futility, shadows of death. I fear the big hurt, the final loss. I know, and I'm honest, death is waiting for me at the end of every road. I'd rather just not think about that. We're able to look it straight in the eye. Walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Many evils beset us. I fear none of them. You're with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Oh, I'm supposed to. His rod and staff, they comfort you. He prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. He anoints your head with oil. Your cup overflows. Just pours it on again. Even more intimate, personal. Now it's not sheep metaphor. Now it's your person. But it's right in the middle of your trouble. There's somebody who meets you, right? And you think of the alternative. Are my friends really my friends? Other people use me for their own ends. I can't really trust anyone. No one has my back. No one's really for me except me. I'm for me. I'm a good person. I can affirm myself. I can love myself. But sometimes I'm so much about me that it's kind of sickening, if I'm honest. And I belong to no one except myself. That's the logic. The anti-psalm is the logic of life without a shepherd. You're all alone, and it's all about you. And death is at the end of it. Death is your shepherd. And you just think how that reality walks you, enters into the things you struggle with. And then the end. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life, and you shall return to the house of the Lord forever. You know what's going on in those verses? Goodness and mercy are being used as a kind of stand-in for the Lord, because the Lord is the one who reveals himself on Mount Sinai as good, as full of steadfast love and kindness and mercy and compassion. And so when it says goodness and love, mercy, steadfast love, follow me, it's actually saying the Lord follows me. Now, what gives it that image? It's actually a picture of how a shepherd leads a flock. When I was in Israel, actually, I saw this out in the desert, Judean desert. Here's the flock. The shepherd is actually, you might say, leading from the back. The shepherd is like was on the back right, where he can see everyone. So he's taking them where they're going, but he's taking them in such a way, he's not charging on ahead where he's not looking at them. He's actually looking at them, considering them, watching them, making sure they're okay. Goodness and mercy are following me. That the shepherd is leading by following, you might say, because he's keeping track of me. And where he's taking me, it's the culmination. This is a journey psalm. This is a lifelong journey, right? That ends up going through the valley of the shadow of death. And you end up, again, I think it can sound kind of clunky, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Maybe that's gets at certain things. The word used for dwell there is actually return. I'm returning. And house doesn't quite do it the way that home does it. We're going to his house. We're going to his home. The shepherd's taking us to his house. Shepherd's taking us home. That's this destination. So lest we think some building like this that's kind of stark and, you know, formal, we're going to his house where we're going to live forever. The alternative. Disappointment follows me all the days of my life. Will I just be obliterated into nothingness? Will I be alone forever, homeless, free falling into void? It's a living death, and then I die. And then you think, this is Hay's story about Elva that was so heartbreaking. You know, they had a happy day looking at her purse. She's an older lady. That was written in the late 80s. She's dead now. She had a happy day and then she died. End of story. But what does it mean that you will live in the home of the person who loves you forever? That's our story. It does seem to me that, you know, as we think about counseling, I'll back out of this a minute and close it. As we think about counseling ministry, it's ministry is going to bring a word that illumines your life. One of my favorite passages in Psalm 119, the unfolding of your words gives light. And you can see how even what we've tried to do in just a little bit of a mass workshoppy thing is think through, okay, here's what my troubles in life are like, and here's how I tend to struggle within myself and stray and get confused and forget God and get anxious or irritated or I complain. And here's this word that actually touches it at every point, even by its contrast with everything that comes naturally, and it brings life and light and hope, and you're not alone. And you think how those problems, which, you know, some of the things, some of you here might have thought of something really big and weighty, and others might have thought of just some daily little irritant, some hassle. You know, your car broke again, and it's going to cost money, and you weren't planning on that $500. And whether it's big or little, it's the same God meets people. Because this camps out on the biggie, death. And by implication, touches all the little shadows of death, all the little evils, that hardships that beset our lives. There's nothing else that provides what Psalm 23 provides, is there? That's been one of the themes of our entire conference. There is a person involved in biblical counseling who walks out of the room with the person that you are talking with. And you don't. They walk out, that same person walks out of the room with you too. And just such a different gig. Maybe we should have probably a different word than counseling, except that it's dealing with the same issues. Yeah, it's just pastoral care, care of souls, hands-on, conversational ministry, discipleship, whatever you want to, you know, real-life discipleship. And then consider this, I'll close with it. Only Christian faith, only biblical counseling intrinsically ends with three things that no other system, model of counseling does. It ends with gratitude and joy and love. Those are the goals. That's where it's trending, right? Those aren't the goals, because there's no one to be grateful for. And at the end of the day, there's no real reason for joy beyond, Heath brought that out so well this earlier today, beyond this momentary happiness at a little human connect that lets me lighten up a little. But joy. Joy is the emotion of intimacy and relationship. And that's why, you know, when John will say, that our joy may be complete. My joy will be complete when I'm with you and we're with the one we both love. We're back in the family reunion. And gratitude is an interpersonal feeling, action, words. And joy is an interpersonal feeling and action and words. And love is interpersonal. It's what we do and what we say and what we think and how we treat people and how we feel about them. And there's these interpersonal things that we have such a lovely, lovely faith that leads to these spectacular goods that we as human beings created in the image of God, drastically fallen. We are made to end up where gratitude and joy and love are the last word on the story. And they are things that aren't a last word. They're an eternal word. They're the word that just goes on and on and on forever. We get the privilege in ministry of aiding that. Let me pray for us. Our Father, thank you so much that you choose to meet us through words that are different from any other kind of words. They're words that reveal you. They're actually, the things you say are actually true. They make sense of life. They bring hope. They hit us upside the head. They humble us. They challenge us. We are so grateful to be Christians. We are so grateful that you are willing to take a heart of stone out of a man, out of a woman, and put in a heart that is tender and soft and receptive and pliable, and that you pour the love of God in our hearts. Lord, often through suffering, God, who would have thought it, that in the context of sin and misery, that we would discover the love of God. Help us to be faithful, help us to love well, make us wiser in our counsel, and we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.